Describing a horror film as both dull and nasty could be seen as a paradox. However, once in a while comes along a horror flick that's so blatantly and aggressively out of touch with its human story that you find your eyes slowly closing together in boredom, only for them to be ripped wide open when confronted with a jarring burst of repulsive and exploitative violence. Sure, it's a pretty common technique to subvert expectations and catch you off guard, but when you're dealing with this particular monstrosity, you'll think it's two awful films stitched together by a filmmaker high on his own vanity. Megan Is Missing is a found footage film I have forever avoided covering since watching Your Movie Sucks review many years back, yet ever since its brief hellish resurgence on TikTok during the pandemic, of course it was inevitable I would get flooded with requests. Despite hating it with every passionate bone in my brittle body and avoiding any requests to send me a copy, as miserable luck would have it, it recently found itself death-staring me in the face, and while I could just put it to the side and come up with a lame excuse not to cover it, this time, however...
My hands are kinda tied on this one. Yeah, it's a long backstory, so all I'll say is, go watch my crossover with Diamanda Hagen on her channel, where we reviewed The Boys from County Hell, because this review is...
It's a debt that he was more than happy to pay.
Okay, Brian, yeah, he's here too. Play the music.
Oh, fuck, you're one of those YouTubers, aren't you?
If we're going to review this properly, we're going to do it my goddamn way. Helps drown out all the...
The fucking pronunciation. However...
Megan Is Missing tells the story of two 14-year-old girls who, surprise surprise, go missing 3 weeks apart in January 2007, and what we're presented with is a collection of phone calls, videos, and news clips pieced together to create a timeline of their disappearances and aftermath. The film was the brainchild of cinematographer Michael Goy, who told Entertainment Weekly in 2020 following the film's viral resurgence on TikTok, was conceived while working with a forensic investigator on another project, and his apparent frustrations with, to quote, sensationalistic depictions of internet predators in programs like To Catch a Predator.
According to Wikipedia, it's one of the earliest screen life films, predating the most famous example, Unfriended, by nearly a decade, though coming 6 years after the original screen life film, The Collingswood Story, which I also have a copy of, Ryan. Although personally, I'd say that Megan Is Missing is only arguably a screen life film, because it doesn't show the desktop and the visual quality has none of the lag or glitches that you'd expect from webcams and stuff, which makes parts of the film feel more like a fake documentary than a screen life film. Plus, there's whole sections that clearly aren't on computers, and I can't think how many people were using video calls that much at the time.
Goy wrote, directed, edited, and produced the film on a self-funded budget of $35,000 with little to no professional backing bar his 30 years of industry experience, with the script itself being based on several true events clobbered together to make this Frankenstein of sensationalism that Goy believed would serve as a PSA to warn parents of the dangers their children face when online. However, everything I've read about Goy seems to undermine his supposed message when it feels more like he enjoys relishing in the controversy and extreme content, which comes off as hypocritical and unhealthy, given he's exploiting the exploitation of what his film is about. Hell, New Zealand even outright banned the film because, in their words, it was horrifically objectionable in how it shows teenagers being tortured, assaulted, and killed. Let's not split hairs about what this is. Goy says you can make a film like this today, and well, yes you can, but it's not any more objectionable than it was back then.
While it is technically effective in provoking the horrors of real-life predators, what's interesting is that I actually turned 13 on the day of Megan's supposed disappearance, so when the film was made, the story was targeted at my demographic.
Plus, it's the equivalent of waving a loaded gun in people's faces just to let you know that you know the guns are in fact bad.
However, within the first 30 seconds, despite Goy apparently basing his dialogue on real teenage conversations, it becomes clear this is boomer material with little nuance or understanding of actual teenagers.
Daddy loves me. Yeah, well, mine love me too, slut. bitch.
Yeah, the performances aren't great, but at least they're consistently not great. In fact, for young amateurs, it's a miracle it's not worse. And it does let you get into a vibe with it regardless. So the jackhammer of an ending still has the full effect. We're first introduced to Megan and Amy, longtime best friends, who decide to use Amy's new expensive camcorder to document their friendship, which mostly consists of them calling each other whores and sluts, because apparently there's no better way to make them sympathetic and relatable before we're informed of their disappearance as.
Oh yeah, Goy also edited this film.
Before I was blind, I could see what it was going for with the use of the literal impact font. I mean, this is serious missing child shit. Lock your doors, board up your windows, hang up your crosses, activate your goddamn sensory turrets.
You're a hoe, H-O-ho.
Jealousy talking, blah blah blah.
Again, I see what it's going for with Megan and Amy's show-offy naive attempts at maturity, where they drop their innocence when adults aren't around like we all did as teenagers, but it severely overplays the perverse and offensive language to the point it's like a raunchy 90s comedy divorced from what's on screen. Sure, South Park did the exact same thing, but it was ruthlessly self-aware about it, and you know, was pretty funny as well. Now, something that intrigues me is how it indirectly frames their relationship as fairly toxic, where instead of showing the loving bond between them, which is what I think the film is genuinely trying to go for, it portrays Megan as taking advantage of Amy's timid and sensitive personality, and in turn, Amy is trying to match it by mimicking Megan's sass, much to her own discomfort.
Wait. Are you seriously analyzing this film?
Look, obviously I can't speak from the female perspective, but I do remember trying to fit in with the cool guys in school by going completely against my own character, thinking it would make me feel validated when really I just ended up being laughed at, building a deeper crater of anxiety and whoo, let's not get into it.
Hey Meg, did you get some of that shit Tersal had today?
No, was it good?
Fucking awesome, girl.
Fuck, he didn't even tell me he had some. Last time I blow him.
By the way, we're only 2 minutes into this, and this couldn't be any more. How do you do, fellow teenagers? In a later Skype chat, Megan is talking to a friend about drugs and sexual escapades, when we're introduced to a friend's gross 40-year-old grooming boyfriend before being interrupted by Megan's aggressive mother screaming about Megan unplugging the VCR.
The movie poses a potential conflict by implying Megan is from an emotionally abusive household, thus her edgelord mean streak behavior in front of Amy is an unhealthy coping mechanism to give her some power and control in her own life.
Well, I do see what you mean. She is basically bullying Amy as an outlet for her BS. A point that does not exist in the text, but we can pretend that it does to make it a somewhat competent movie.
I mean, yeah, it somewhat gets the social hierarchy of being a teenager correct. You'll get the hang of analyzing these non-existent elements in no time. How long's left?
We are literally 5 minutes in.
Motherfuck!
Next, we're introduced to perhaps the film's more, interesting character, Ben, who's hosting a house party Megan and her other group of friends are invited to. Megan asks Ben if she can invite Amy, but Ben refuses because, in his words, he has a reputation to think about, like a sleazy pimp, and Amy simply isn't one of the cool kids. He does reluctantly agree when Megan threatens not to attend because she's his premier party girl, even antagonizing her to perform sexual favors in exchange for the invite.
You can see the movie setting up constant red flags around Megan, with the excessive emphasis on drugs, peer pressure, and promiscuous activities. It does make for an uncomfortable tone, since everything we see is unending soap opera-level drama, with minimal downtime to remind us that these people are still kids at the end of the day. If Goy wasn't so quick to jump to the dangers and actually took the time to write a better script with nuanced characterization, it could have shown how insidious predatory practices and behaviors work in targeting naive teenagers seeking to be noticed, accepted, and validated. Instead, it takes on this incredibly cynical, harmful worldview that teenagers are surrounded by nothing but danger. They go to a house party where we see drink, drugs, questionable age gaps, and repulsive, sleazy behavior, and while I've never been in a scenario as intense as this, I could feel the palpable discomfort Amy goes through. She's then harassed and assaulted by that slimy groomer from the earlier Skype chat, I assume in an effort to set him up as a suspect in their eventual disappearance, and then she walks in on a badly inebriated Megan being essayed by Ben.
Is it horrific? Of course it is, but the grotesque behavior we see prior to this, it's impossible not to view this as excessively exploitative. Do these things happen? Yes. Do we need to see everything for the point to have impact? No.
Probably. There is an art to subtlety and implication, which, you know, I am aware of, even though I clearly don't employ it myself. And I have nothing against extreme cinema, but the point of it is to provoke. And for a subject matter like this, there has to be a point to the challenge, which the movie doesn't do. The very next scene doesn't meaningfully address what happened, it's just Megan talking in distressing detail about her other promiscuous escapades.
It's not thoughtful, it's voyeuristic.
It's also kind of shit. We're only 15 minutes in, by the way.
You've got to be kidding me!
From here, there's a bleak irony introduced when Megan talks about wanting to run away and escape her troubled life, with Amy even agreeing to go with her. And very soon, what follows is an introduction to our faceless antagonist, Josh. Megan Skypes Josh after receiving his contact info from a friend, but red flags immediately show when the mysterious Josh tells Megan he's a high schooler but can't share his webcam because it's apparently broken, eventually charming and persuading Megan to meet him at a party. During this, Amy begins to vlog about her insecurities and future, suggesting a potentially poignant avenue to develop her empathetically as someone with a bright future cut short by the grim eventuality, but before we learn anything, we cut straight back to a hungover Megan telling Amy that Josh never showed up. In a follow-up call, Megan scorns Josh, but he claims he panicked and was too shy to show up, and very effortlessly manages to manipulate her into meeting him again.
Would you like to meet up and maybe get some ice cream or something?
Yes, I would.
Cool. Well, that was easy.
Even he's surprised about how little work he needed to convince her to give him a second chance. His creepiness is not subtle at all, even though she's an impressionable 14-year-old. Later that day, Megan brings Amy on a call to meet Josh, only to quickly tell her to leave so she can be alone with Josh. He sends an alleged photo of himself to make up for not having a working webcam.
I'm sorry, I can be kind of a smartass sometimes.
Sometimes? Is smartass not her entire personality?
I was thinking more dumbass.
I would never hurt you, Megan.
I know.
You've never met him!
Do you trust me?
Yes.
You know, as someone who has killed multiple people...
Wait, what the fuck?
I just want you to know, she's fucking dead.
How long did they hold that shot for?
About 25 seconds.
Can we just call it quits now?
Oh no, we're only about halfway through.
Ah, Christ.
Where?
Motherfucker owes me 12 bucks.
Somewhere, a mother cries out, "My child is missing."
In the following days, Megan is finally declared officially missing, as Amy attempts to inquire with Megan's friends to no avail, eventually turning to Josh, who also claims to be concerned.
One fact remains, Megan is missing.
Look, I know some news networks are a bit trigger-happy when it comes to editing, but this is very mid-2000s high school morning announcements on a crappy website using Flash.
I like it, because it's so obviously fake due to budget limitations, but with how many local and public access broadcasts exist, audiences can certainly buy into it, especially when it's playing on sensationalism.
We eventually see CCTV of Megan's abduction, leading Amy to accuse Josh of being the kidnapper, and even managing to dodge his perversions and attempts at manipulation, causing Josh to invert his tactics to mocking her insecurities with the pettiest of insults.
You just said I was sexy.
Then you're stupid too.
There is further irony in Josh pretending to be a high schooler and insulting like a preschooler. It signals to me where the realism begins to fall apart, because the final stretch to Amy's abduction gets ridiculous and random without a point.
Amy eventually turns to the police, but is harassed by news reporters and Megan's friends, the latter of whom accuse Amy of apparently ruining Megan's life and trying to exploit her disappearance for profit and attention. I get that they're likely going through some form of grief and looking for someone to blame, but can we take a second to address the massive elephant in the room that's incredibly easy to miss? It's important to remember that Megan does not meet Josh out of some random catfishing chatroom encounter. His details are specifically given to Megan by her friend Lexi, this girl, by the way. Now, maybe I'm just being conspiratorial, but listen to Lexi's impulsive outburst just as Amy leaves.
This is all your fault! And I can't fix it! There's nothing I can fucking do!
Am I right in thinking that Lexi seems to know what likely happened to Megan? Because the performance reads as both guilty and heartbroken. Heartbroken because she loved Megan and Megan loved her, and guilty because she can't fix this? That makes me think she knows what Josh is capable of.
Why did you even give this guy's details to a girl you claim to love? If you know he's dangerous, wouldn't it make more sense to give the details to Amy who desires validation? That way, if you separate Amy from Megan, you can have Megan all to yourself. Even if you don't think he was dangerous, all you did was cockblock yourself.
I know I've shat on the script for being shallow the whole way through, but there's something so specific about her dialogue that screams complicit. Like, oh shit, what have I done? I can't undo this, so I'm going to channel my pain onto Amy because she's trying to expose Josh, who will likely try to cover his tracks, which is what he effectively does when he later calls Amy and threatens her. However, before this, Amy goes on a melancholic journey to see all the locations she and Megan spent together, and in the underpass shot, you can see Josh emerging from the tree line. It's not subtle, but I have a soft spot for shots like this, and don't worry if you miss it, because the movie will make sure to call back to it when Amy's camera is eventually found.
As days pass, Serena enactment to the CCTV is made in the apparent hopes of somehow uncovering more insight into her disappearance. I think the sequence is meant to play in the media's excessive need to sensationalize and capitalize on harrowing true stories, but it doesn't make any meaningful point of it, and instead it just feels like padding.
It's really just delaying the inevitable, the big shock, horror, disturbing moment that gave this film its infamy. I'm going to blur it out for obvious reasons, but since I wrote this script, you can do the honors of explaining it.
So, after 6 weeks without a lead, suddenly the owner of a fetish website contacts the FBI over two disturbing photographs of a distressed girl in a violent torture device, later identified as Megan. In the shell shock of what we just witnessed, we return to Amy at the underpath a month prior, where she's also abducted by Josh. Further news coverage highlights the efforts to find the girls, Amy's grieving parents, and the discovery of Amy's camera, where the final 22 minutes of footage were filmed by Josh.
Here is the quickest rundown of what happens. We see Amy chained in a cold, dingy cell where she's mocked, humiliated, and depravedly forced to eat like an animal before being given her childhood teddy bear as a reward for her subordination. We're then made to suffer through, I swear to God, a 3-minute essay scene. It's a fucking snuff film. Yeah, it's fiction, but oh my dear loving God, Jesus Christ, did it really have to show us this?
Best you have a lot of shots at the ready when you watch this. It makes it easier. I think it plays into the horror of the mundane quite well. Things just get constantly worse and worse, and for found footage to work, there has to be a realistic acceptance of it to properly work. It feels real to the point that you're questioning the tightrope between reality and non-reality. It's not for everyone, but arguably the anticlimactic quality keeps you in this tight, fragile headspace that you almost forget that you're watching a piece of fiction. Although, for as devastating as it is, it's hard to accept that the killer deliberately filmed Amy's last days and then threw the camera in the trash. Even him lunging from off screen to grab Amy feels forced. It reminded me of that line from Shadow the Vampire. If it's not in frame, it doesn't exist. But when the film does work, you spend the whole time wanting something artificial like music to remind you that it's a film, because that would indicate that the cavalry might be coming, that she might be okay, but you know she won't be.
It's so unnecessarily excessive that it seems to fetishize violence in order to fearmonger its point about the dangers of the online world. I understand shock value has its purpose, and yes, it's effective, but to then preach some cautionary message regresses everything to exploitative propaganda to grotesquely convince you off its fucking argument. Look, do things like this happen? Unfortunately, yes, but there's no craft or artistry in the storytelling to justify the points it's built around. And I say that as someone who's a fan of plenty of extreme films. I've even recommended many on occasion.
I realize that all I'm gonna do is convince some people to watch this, but this is one of those films that can easily be characterized as self-harm via cinema. Don't watch it unless that's what you want. I've done videos on the vomit gore films, the guinea pig films, August Underground Mortem, the schizophrenic The Whore Mangler films, and forgive me for R-A-P-I-N-G-ing you, but even I still found this difficult to watch.
And I haven't seen any of those films because I'm emotionally held together with duct tape.
You're also a wuss.
Also a wuss.
The movie ends with Josh revealing Megan's decaying corpse in a barrel and trapping Amy inside with her before taking her to an empty field where they're both buried together forever. Honestly, I think this scene is far more effective than any of the gratuitous stuff it shows us before. It's so simple, but the reveal of Megan's corpse and then locking Amy alive in the same barrel is a powerful way to end what's otherwise a poorly put together film. How long does this burial scene last?
It's 10 minutes of uncut footage.
Aw, son of a bitch.
Okay, I did it. It's done. I finally covered. Megan is missing. You can stop requesting it now. It's done. It's out of my head. We can move on now. So until next time, stay safe. Stay away from...
Stay away from guys called Josh. Unless, of course, you mean Josh Snares, who's a very wholesome Doctor Who YouTuber. Okay, so, you know, he's fine. And, you know, if you're watching this, Josh, I know you're a big fan of Hollinger, you know...
And we'll see you all very soon, I guess?
Yep, indeed, you will. It'll be great. Come now, Brian!
Wait, what about me? I performed the deep magic. Can I let me go now? Can we? This is...
How about this? We'll keep the film going just to keep you company. You seem very, very lonely without it. And if you manage to cut yourself free with the DVD, then you can go free. Because it rhymes. Come on, Brian!